Thank you, everyone. It was a to me, sitting here and listening and taking notes, it was a wonderful experience, eye-opening and knowledge-enhancing experience. So I must thank all of you for participating and having this wonderful discussion on a good day in Bangalore. Especially, I must make these very important thank you notes. You know, the thank you to our wonderful partners in the US Consulate General in Chennai. Biju Kumar and Eric have been wonderful in helping to make this happen. We worked this out at short notice. The speakers came at short notice. Everything happened at short notice, and we had a good conference. So thank you very much. Visitors from outside Bangalore, welcome to my city. Sorry for the traffic. Enjoy the beer. Enjoy the alcohol. Right? And today is a Saturday, so Friday, so I hope you have a good weekend in this city as well. The Takshashila team, led by Guru, Pranay, Hamsini, Devika, Manasa, everybody who was hanging around the office has been roped in by Commodore Uday Rao. And so he's just gotten all of these guys, and everybody's been shanghaied into this enterprise, as you call it in naval terms. So thank you to the team as well, and the ladies from Mount Carmel for turning up bunking classes to attend this. Okay, a few remarks about the conference and what I sort of took away from this. And I'll start with Swati's point, which is really the zeroth point in this. When we talk about coastal security, is what is it that we are securing? Most of our emphasis tends to be securing the physical targets or human from violence against perpetrated against them. It could be terrorism, it could be organized crime. But largely, our mindset is devoted towards protecting targets from attack, violent attack. But Swati's question, although it came in the end, sort of expands what we really should be thinking about in terms of coastal security. It's not just threats to life, but it's threats to ways of life, threats to livelihood, threats to environment, and much more than that. And I think one of the important additions to this conversation on coastal security is the expansive view of coastal security. The second is, and I was just passing a note to Saurabh sitting next to me, this is another instance of coastal security is another instance of policy making in a very noisy environment. When I say noisy, you have lakhs of boats which are unregistered and a few lakhs of boats which are registered. And now you're trying to develop a system which would handle the contingency of both kinds of boats. So your signal to noise ratio, which, I mean, a figure of merit to a good engineer, which most of us are, the signal of noise ratio is very low, and you're trying to make judgments, decisions, design systems, operations in a very low signal to noise ratio. And I think this is part of the challenge. And as a realist, I would say this is the way we have to take the world as it stands. You know, this is the world as it is. And whatever we do must work in a world which is like this. Instead of hoping that we are like Switzerland and we do coastal security of Switzerland, which is pretty easy to do. The third point is about the political economy of coastal security. And this conversation came about in my first interaction with Commodore Uday Rao many, many months ago, is why is it that the states are not interested in coastal security? Because it happens on their shores. It might involve targets in their state or citizens of their state. Economic assets in their state. And yet there is a psychology among state governments which says that, look, coastal security is not really our priority. It's somebody's priority. Is it because the union government, they're so used to relying on the union government for national security that they think that this is not their job? Or is it because they have way too many other things on their plates which happen far more regularly, which have far more political, economic, and social impact that, you know, one terrorist attack every 10 years, maybe we can, you know, take that. It's not a big deal. So I think it's important for us as analysts to understand this political economy. Why is it that the states have this ambivalent or apathetic attitude towards coastal security without making value judgments on that? Because getting into value judgments and saying that, you know, state governments are disinterested, they're apathetic, they don't care about security, gets us into a very different zone of thinking, right? as realists, I think it behoves us to look at this question without making value judgments. The third point is the political economy of forces, of the armed forces. And this came to me, and this coastal security is another instance of this. I was talking to General Muttanna when he was helping the Karnataka police with their counter-terrorist operation, setting up a counter-terrorism force. And General Muttanna told me that in Karnataka, being an armed policeman is a second-class citizen. You're a second-class policeman. If you're a civil policeman, you're an unarmed policeman, it's cool. You know, you have higher status, you have higher social status and career prospects within the organization, as opposed to being an armed policeman. I thought this is like inverse, right? You always think that an armed policeman is of higher status. And he says, yes, in Tamil Nadu it is so, but in Karnataka it's not. So, you know, there are these variations of what is of higher status, what gets you better prospects, monetary career prospects, that seems to influence these decisions on how do we equip these forces. And I think we again have to understand these things. And this is a question which struck me, that we have to understand the political economy and probably even the sociology of military forces before we can make recommendations on how to equip these and what role they should play. Finally, the ray of hope to me seems from the area of technology, right? Most of it is, and being in Bangalore, it's the first thing which hits you is the technological part. And Chaitanya, in his presentation, made some of those points, is that if we look away from this old tendency of looking at big, expensive, and few systems, you have, you know, a big computer or a big platform, which is highly expensive, and then you just have one or two of these things. If you move away from that thinking into thinking of small, cheap, and many, so there are small, there are small sensors. They're all over the place. They're dispensable. You can replace them very easily. You can manufacture them. You don't really mind. You don't have to spend millions of dollars or crores of rupees defending them or protecting them. You know, if it breaks, it breaks. If we think in these terms, I think there are a lot more solutions that are available for us to think about these problems in terms of when we were being when heard these voices of lacks of ships that we can't track them, it for some of us who are working in areas of technology, it doesn't look like an intractable problem. A million boats out in the sea probably was intractable 10 years ago, but is not that intractable today. And this city is probably the place where it is least intractable, because I suppose there are tens of startups and entrepreneurs trying to develop systems to track objects, Internet of Things and other things. So technology probably is an answer. And I think part of our job has to be to connect the technologists and the innovators to the people who need those solutions. And Chaitanya is exactly in that zone. And I'm sure there are a lot of these entrepreneurs in various areas. And part of what we have to do at Takshashila is probably to figure out how to connect the entrepreneurs, innovators, technologists to the people who need them. And those of you who've been present in this room, to the extent that you can help make this connection, do work with us to make that happen. On that note, I want to thank you, all of you, again for coming. And enjoy, so we can step out quickly and enjoy the rest of the wonderful Friday and the weekend, and then before we all go home. So thank you all. And hope to see you again in future conferences.